This is a refurbished 27-inch 5K iMac that I bought through Apple's refurbished site, and it was a nice upgrade from the previous 2012 model I had. However, when I purchased this Mac, there was no way I could upgrade any of the internals, so that left me with an i5 quad-core 3.4GHz, 8GB of RAM, and a 1TB Fusion hard drive. Previously, I upgraded the RAM to 16GB in order to assist with virtualization. However, the Fusion drives that Apple puts in its iMac is basically a 7200 RPM hard drive with an NVMe SSD drive to work as cache. In your system settings, it'll show as one hard drive though, with software masking the fact that your iMac does have an inserted NVMe drive that is used to help increase its performance. Unfortunately, the majority of the time, you'll be dealing with much slower SATA drive speeds than what you would be if you'd have purchased the SSD upgrade system when you go to buy a new iMac off of Apple's website. Sadly though, I can't independently verify that purchasing a new iMac with SSD will take advantage of the PCIe transfer speeds, or SATA 3 speeds. There's no mention of what kind of style of hard drive you'll be getting when you order a new 27-inch iMac. Also, choosing to upgrade the storage of it is $500 more for a 1TB SSD configured version, which is pretty expensive compared to the current options available. A bit of a disclaimer though, I can't independently verify whether the cost difference to the aftermarket SSDs are even comparable to what Apple would ship with you if you were to do the upgrade with them. So that brings me to the point of this video. The spinning drive that is currently inside of the iMac was giving out and causing many performance issues with the iMac. It was taking super long for the computer to boot up, and it once took over 5 minutes for it to launch the Microsoft Excel app. I wanted to bring this computer up to speed, and the best way to do so was to replace the hard drive. But instead of replacing the spinning drive itself, I decided to replace the NVMe drive only. I did this to get the best performance possible, as SATA will bottleneck the performance of modern SSDs due to its connection. My goal was to replace the NVMe drive solely. I decided to keep the same mechanical hard drive and use it as a secondary storage device, because removing it may conflict with the thermal sensor inside, causing the fan to consistently run at high speeds. Today, I want to talk about the process of upgrading the NVMe drive inside of an iMac. It is not an easy process by any means, and I would watch this video in full and refer back to it if you'd like to undergo this kind of upgrade yourself. I want to give as much detail as possible and sum up some of the things that you should be made aware of before attempting to crack open the iMac. While researching on how to do this kind of upgrade, I got a lot of conflicting information, so I want to clear the air on many things. So let's begin. First, let's go over the different parts and tools that you'll need to get this done. For the SSD, I chose the 970 EVO Plus for about $190. As of currently, Apple doesn't support some M.2 drives. So far, both the 970 EVO and EVO Plus have been verified with being able to run macOS. I can also independently verify that the 970 EVO does work, as I'm currently using it with my 2014 MacBook Pro, which I upgraded back in February. You'll also need an adapter in order to fit it into the PCIe slot of the iMac. Apple uses a proprietary connector for its blade drives. For this, I got the Syntec adapter for about $17. For the adapter, you may or may not need this Captain tape for about $5. I bought the iFixit ProTech toolkit for $70 a few years ago when it first came out, and I would highly recommend getting it, especially for this kind of upgrade, as you'll see why soon. You may also want to get an anti-static mat with this. I would recommend a medium to large size one. They go for about $45. This Audison display opening tool is needed for about $7, as well as this service wedge repair tool for about $11 to make some things easier. I would also grab a small set of pliers if you have some laying around. Also, don't forget the adhesive strips for the iMac's display. Those were about $9 on eBay. Lastly, you'll need a bootable macOS removable storage. You can do this by either downloading the latest macOS from the Mac App Store and creating a bootable flash drive with it, or what I recommend is backing up all of your data by creating a Time Machine backup with an external hard drive. Both methods will create a bootable macOS, but Time Machine will hold a backup of all your files, which you should be doing anyways before you do this upgrade. In total, it looks like this upgrade will cost you about $354 if you were to buy the parts I listed here. That is to say that you don't already own some of the tools and things you'll need. Now, let's move on to the actual upgrade process. One of the things that I don't see being discussed enough is proper computer technician etiquettes. What I mean is, before dealing with any kind of disassembly of any computers, you should make sure that you have the proper workspace to limit the amount of static being formed and possibly discharging on your bare computer electronics. I would look up videos about proper ESD safety and educating yourself about these practices so that you don't accidentally fry your motherboard, like I've done before. It's way better to be safe than sorry. I also used gloves as much as possible when handling the computer parts as to prevent the oils on my skin from harming any of the computer parts. You also want to make sure that you give yourself enough time to do this project. This took me just about all day because I was being super gentle and slow with everything. I was also making sure I was recording the process and taking notes when necessary. I don't know about you guys, but I don't have a ton of money to put down on a brand new iMac if this one completely fails after reassembly, so please, take your time. When disassembling the iMac, I followed the guide created by iFixit for their Intel 27-inch blade SSD replacement. This guide is for an iMac made between late 2014 and 2015. Although mine is a 2017 model, this guide closely resembled my disassembly process. However, yours may vary depending on what year it was made. I noticed that some minor things like screw sizes were usually common, which is why I recommend the iFixit Pro Kit, so that if any of these things were to occur, then you should be prepared. When I got to the point of removing the power supply, there were two things I did a bit differently from the guide recommends. For the power supply control cable, I disconnected it from the logic board rather than the power supply unit itself. On the logic board, I found that it is stuck to it through some adhesive. I was able to peel it off slowly from the board by using one of the spudgers found within the kit. Another difficulty here was with the DC power cable. It was super difficult to pull out with just your hands alone. So this is where I pulled out some pliers to grip onto the sides of this connector. And with my left hand, I was able to push down on the tab using my thumb to release the cable. Together, I used both hands to carefully pull out the cable. When it came to removing the logic board, I found that there was an additional T10 screw along the bottom left-hand corner, as well as a T10 screw on the underside of the logic board next to the exhaust duct. Lastly, there was a small zipped cable that connects to the microphone near the bottom of this board. I just carefully pulled this out. I was finally able to access the blade SSD on the back of this board. When installing the new one, I made sure to follow the instructions involving adding Captain Tape near the bottom of the connectors that connect to the logic board. I don't really think this was necessary though, as this was recommended for people to do through this MacRumors forum. It's to help insulate the connection and prevent electrical shorting. However, I believe this might have been due to a faulty adapter. You'll also notice that the drive and the adapter cause the blade to stretch out further past where the screw that holds down the drive goes. You can still screw it in though if you attempt to do so by screwing it in at an angle. This of course may strip out the hole, so make sure you only attempt to do so once. You'll also notice that it causes the SSD to flex a bit, so I made sure to stop screwing it in after I was able to see that it was securely in place. After installing the new SSD, I went ahead preparing the screen for re-adhering. However, re-adhering the screen presented its own challenges. It took me a while to completely scrape off and clean off the old adhesive. Since it's really hard to get your hands on some rubbing alcohol these days, I used industrial grade acetone, and I was super careful not to get any of it on any components. In fact, that's why I started this process now, since all of the iMac components were outside of the chassis, I wouldn't have to worry about it as much. After that, it was on to applying the adhesive strips. The strips I used were recommended by Snazzy Labs when he upgraded his own iMac, and one issue I found with them is that the top left strip is much longer than needed, so you would need to cut it down. Also, I've seen some conflicting reports on how you should go about reapplying the screen. Some tutorials say to apply the bottom adhesive strips to the bottom of the screen, while others say to apply them all to the iMac chassis. I went ahead and applied the bottom strips to the bottom of the screen, as it seemed as though that's the way the factory installed them initially. However, that caused problems later, as I noticed that the bottom strips overlapped some of the side strips. This caused my iMac screen to now not sit as flush with the chassis. You can now see a bit of a gap in between the bottom portion of the iMac. I let the iMac sit face up in between two chairs with large textbooks sitting on top of it for about 12 hours in order to help adhere to the screen. I then used some clamps I had lying around to continue putting pressure on the border of the screen where I placed the adhesive strips for over a day, just to make sure that the adhesive stuck securely. You may not need to do all of this, but I've read countless horror stories of people not applying the screen properly and that they woke up to a shattered 5K iMac screen. Lastly, another issue I found was with the microphone after applying the screen. The microphone sounded very muffled after applying the screen with the adhesive, and I verified that the microphone was functional before applying any adhesive. What's odd is that I saw what looked like to be a microphone cutout on the bottom of the screen. However, I also read online that the screen placement differs between different iMac models in that my particular model has its microphone arranged towards the bottom of the Apple logo, and was even echoed by this girl's YouTube video. Also, when this is assembling the screen, there was adhesive over the microphone cutout already, so I figured it wouldn't be a problem. Weirdly enough though, this problem just went away. I can now hear clearly through the microphone. My guess is that it probably had something to do with the clamps applying more pressure than usual on the screen, or that it kind of seems like the adhesive itself is loosening a bit, as I can now start to dig my fingernails slightly between the screen glass and the chassis. But I think it has more to do with the fact that there is double the adhesive than necessary on the bottom corners. This is even amplified a bit when I first turn on the iMac screen. You can see some light discoloration on the far corners edges of the screen. The backlight also doesn't appear as uniform as before. A big tip in this case would be to make sure that you have an extra pair of hands to assist you in reapplying the screen. You need to make sure that you line it up correctly, as well as making sure that you have the screen's cables connected correctly by turning on the iMac to reveal the boot logo. Doing all this alone is really tricky, so I wouldn't recommend it. Some forum users recommend using painter's tape to help hold and line up the display correctly while you put it back into place. Unfortunately, I didn't have any laying around. This means later on I'll be reapplying the screen again just to make sure I get the perfect fit and that I exclude applying adhesive on the top of the microphone cutouts. So, after everything is reassembled, now what? Well, you need to connect your bootable macOS storage device, then booting up the iMac, you'll need to hold down the Option key in order to boot into your bootable macOS device. You will not be able to use Internet Recovery anymore, as your new SSD will not support that. From there, you'll go to Utilities and Open Disk Utilities to format your new M.2 SSD to APFS format. You'll also be able to see your other mechanical hard drive in there as well, but you won't be able to read it or use it until you reformat. Obviously, this means all the data will be lost inside of it. Once you've done that, you can then install macOS onto your new SSD. This process will take quite a bit of time, and your iMac will restart several times. So don't worry about it. At this time, find something to do, like clean up and kill some time, as this could take up to 45 minutes. After that, you're good to go, and you should be taken through the setup process for macOS. I decided not to recover from my backup for my reinstallation, as I wanted a clean OS to start from. I typically only use my backups in case of an emergency, as most of my files are all stored on either iCloud or some other external drive anyways. Now, how's that performance? Well, the new SSD exceeded my expectations. Boot times have gone down significantly, and everything is much more responsive and snappy, just like it should be. I also run virtual machines using the new Parallels 15, and its performance has definitely improved with the introduction of the SSD as well. One thing you want to do though is view your system report and verify your SSD is registered as using X4 link width under the NVMe Express tab, and that trim support says yes. If these are not the values I've told you, such as the link width is shown as X2, then you may have a bad adapter. Trim should be supported right out of the box, but in case it isn't, you can enable it in Terminal, and there are articles online that help show you how to do that. Other than that, this was a solid upgrade, and it definitely helped save me a lot of money in the long run, as well as breathe new life into the system. So a couple of notes to end out this video. Initially, the 970 Evo Plus was not supported to run macOS, and it would cause the system to crash until Samsung later released a firmware update to make it possible. I thought that buying a new Samsung M.2 drive that I would have to update the firmware manually before installing it into the iMac. In order to do something like this though, you would need to run it through Samsung's Magician software that only runs on Windows. I also thought I could run it through the program by using an external adapter that connects via USB Type-C, but that ended up not being the case as the drive could not be recognized when it was being connected through an enclosure. In order for the program to be able to read it, I needed to install it inside an M.2 slot internally. Thankfully, I had a Windows laptop that was able to help me with doing that. However, the program stated that the firmware was already installed so that I didn't need to do anything. But since I was there anyways, I went ahead and did things like drive optimization and check the health of the drive just in case. But it seems like Samsung is already shipping out updated hard drives, so this process shouldn't be necessary to you. I would like to give a shout out to RxS0, who created the forum discussing this particular upgrade in great detail in order to help others have some foresight. Before doing this upgrade, I would also recommend that you read through the entire forum like I had, just to know what you should look out for. In fact, most of the information in this video is from that forum. Although I wouldn't say that I followed all of the advice offered inside of the forum. For example, I didn't use a heatsink for the SSD like some others did in order to keep the drive cool. I don't think this was necessary, and I haven't seen any performance degradation after using the SSD inside for over a week already. But this is definitely the go-to place for all the information you need when doing this kind of upgrade. Lastly, let's ask the bigger question. Should you do this upgrade? I would say no, if you don't have a lot of experience with electronics. I've done quite a bit of tinkering before I took on this project, so I wouldn't do something like this if you're just starting out. It's not worth potentially ruining this computer, especially if you really need to use it. However, if you need something to help hold you out until the new ARM-based Macs show up, then this would be that upgrade. It's a lot of work to do and basically requires you to disassemble the entire computer, but I think in the long run, the performance boosts are completely worth it. Anyways, that's all there is to it. If you have any other questions regarding this upgrade, then let me know in the comments below. I've posted all the links to all the parts, tools, and sites you need in the description below as well, so be sure to check those out. Like and subscribe if you want to see more videos like this one, and let me know if you did this upgrade and how it turned out. I'd like to know. And I'll catch up with you guys next time.